Hello everyone and welcome to the After Hours Gaming League. This is week 5 of the 2015 season and I am your caster for the match, Cric, ChRonICwar Catalyst. This should be a very fun match here. We're going to have a very delicious pick ban phase, I assure you. Now we have not gone through these pick bans before, but I can assure you I've got some insight that they're going to be very interesting. So keep your eyes peeled while I introduce these teams. On the blue side, it is Team Crunchyroll. Crunchyroll, for anyone who knows or who watches my stream or watches my uploads fairly frequently, you will know that I am a big fan of the Crunchyroll streaming site. It is a website that puts up anime and allows you to stream that. I am all about watching anime. So that is my jam, as it were. And they're playing for, both teams, in fact, are playing for the charity Child's Play. Child's Play is a charity that brings children in domestic violence shelters or in the hospital. It brings them a way to reconnect with their childhood and try and capture some of that magic that occurs when you're a kid and when you, as a young kid, like, enjoy yourself, just have a sort of bliss about you, and kids who have been through trauma tend to lose that. So this charity tries to bring that bliss back into the children's life through the magic of gaming, a thing that gives all of us quite a lot of bliss as gamers. And they, of course, are playing against, on the red side, Indigo Slate. Indigo Slate is a company that helps other companies like innovate both their like products and also how they interact with their customers, and they've worked with companies as big as like Google and Microsoft before, so definitely a company that is a little non-standard in what it does, but probably has affected you in some way if you've ever needed to get assistance with some sort of Google account you have or anything like that. You've probably benefited in some way from them. So as we look at the pick ban phase here, we do see that Leona coming out. Now, for those of you who haven't done scouting on the match, Leona is actually a hotly contested pick here. There is a bit of flex here in the composition for red side. Both Mustard Lord and the Rainmaker, the Rainmaker is on this Rammus right now. They both play support and jungle, so there is a little flexibility for who can play what lane there. And specifically, both of them, as support, love to play Leona. So I was a little surprised to see Leona not banned out by this blue side here, or first picked, because Leona is a support that person who's on Braum right now, Big Survivor KS, he plays a lot of Leona as well. So I was surprised to see, perhaps there's just not any scouting done, but I'm surprised to see, if there has been scouting done, them allowing the red side to have an opportunity to pick that Leona away from them. But looking overall at the pick ban phase, we see for the red side, Rumble, Aurelia, Riven coming out as the bans here. Pretty strong all around bans there. Not really anything too super targeted. Rumble, very standard top lane. Now, Aurelia, somebody who you definitely don't want to deal with in the top lane if she gets going, especially once she hits that early Triforce item peak. Once she completes that, she can be a nightmare to try and deal with. Possibly doing a lot of bans in that top lane to try and pick that Sion and hope there's nothing he'll go up against that directly counters him. And effectively, it did work out not too badly, as we do see that the Fiddlesticks will be what's going up into the top lane here. And Sion into Fiddlesticks actually shouldn't be too bad of a matchup. I mean, he's not necessarily a highly mobile champ, so he won't be able to avoid a lot of the Fiddle harass. But he will be able to break that channel with his forgetting exactly what ability that is. I'm not gonna look it up, but the knockup that he has will be able to break the fiddle channel. So I wouldn't say a counter, but a little bit of interesting counterplay is opened up in that top lane. So it will be less of just sort of the standard bruiser, punch you in the face, CS, punch you back in the face, CS. There will be a little room for some interesting outplaying in that top lane. And looking over for this blue side, we see the bans were J4, Gnar, Annie, of course, Narvin, a very standard ban nowadays. As of this patch, actually, it shouldn't be. I think it's going to start to lose a little bit of frequency, but still definitely just one of those combos that will always be good. Same with like Jarvan, Orianna, just always going to be a good combo there. And Annie also banned out, becoming one of the more flavorful supports going into this patch. She has a lot of damage. That stun, of course, is always insane, especially when you get it off of the W and get the AoE stun. Nuts. Let alone the Flash Tibbers, which is infamous. So good bans there all around. Looking at the compositions for the teams, the first thing we want to note is that everyone on the blue side has a way to gap close and then be engaged. So Fiddle, he can ult in. Vi, she can ult in or use her Q to jump in. Caitlyn can throw her whatever caliber net behind her and get within range to start attacking. Ahri can spirit rush in. Braum can jump to any one of those four members who just jumped in and then start doing his thing. He can start queuing people to slow their retreat. He can use the Glacial Fissure to try and get some people knocked up and slow them. There's a lot of potential for picks with this team, and a lot of potential for if somebody is caught out, for them to pile on them really quickly and turn what should be an unfavorable team fight completely in the blue side's favor. So that's what we're going to be looking out for largely in this game, even, is just how the blue side uses that composition, the high mobility that their champs do offer. It's not, obviously, you could have higher mobility in the team, but that is enough mobility to where that will probably be the key story of the game overall. And looking over at the red side, we see kind of the opposite of that. I mean, aside from Rammus, the rest of the team is not very mobile at all. Leona is going to be there to help with that. She can use her ultimate to ideally stun, but practically slow a lot of people to give them time to engage. She can lock them down with her Zenith Blade combo as well to try and allow the Sion to actually ult in and get a good shot off of not just his ult, but then his channeling knockup, which will allow Lux to play off of that very well alongside Jinx. So they can get a lot of their AoE down. Jinx can use, she can toggle her auto attacks to those rockets, start doing a lot of damage there. Lux, of course, as anybody who doesn't know what kind of damage Lux can do, watch the last game we just casted. That Lux was really putting on a clinic of how to use that champion well. So Lux certainly is something that can bring a lot of damage here, as I really quickly we'll just move these champions to their proper slots. Get them all nice and pretty for you guys. There we go. All right, so yeah, so we're gonna be watching out for probably Rams to start off that game, running the engage, I should say, for the red side. I'm gonna roll on in, hit somebody, try and taunt people up, and that will give enough of an opportunity for Sion, for Lux, for Leona to start to use their follow-up CC to get really good engagements on. But aside from that Rammus and that Leona, there's not very much strong engagement. Actually, we got to hold on for a minute because it looks like this Lux is actually cut out. Gonna be first blood. Oh no, it actually went over to the Braum. The last auto attack, too strong. But that was full kill participation over to this blue team on that first blood. So one assist to everybody all around, and a nice juicy little gold bonus to the Braum. Well, I think should actually be going back to spend that. It's only 400, but I mean, that's a ruby, Chris. excuse me, a ruby crystal right there. So definitely get a little bit tankier, make your Q do a little bit more damage, start on that path to Sightstone. We'll see if he goes back. It looks like he's probably not going to. He might just be hanging around until the minions are about to spawn, but looks like he's actually going to opt not to go back and spend that gold. I gotta say, I think that's a bit of a mistake here. Definitely want that ruby crystal. I mean, you're Braum. You're going to be going Sightstone as a support Braum. There's no question about that. There's no downside to getting that ruby crystal early. So I definitely myself would have advised him to go back. But personal choice, I suppose. Might have wanted to just hang around, make sure they can push out this wave as quickly as possible, as the red side will be giving that leash over to the Gromp. They will be getting ever so slightly late to that lane, and with the relic shield, they might be looking to shove this wave out. It actually looks like they're not going to shove this wave out, so I'm not really sure what the decision was. Probably just not overthinking it chronically like I am. But that's what I'm all about, baby. Those small differences give you the value. Yeah, actually, we're seeing a lot of damage onto this Ahri early here. Trying to return some of that damage to Lux. Actually, does so pretty effectively. Some good trades back and forth there. But the Lux, if she can land her abilities early and then get autos to proc her passive, does a lot of damage. Can really harass you very heavily in that laning phase. So, gonna have to be a little bit more careful. Is that Ahri in the middle lane here, as we see level 2 now for both people in the bottom lane, as we're, of course, something I forgot to mention, we're treated to the Firecracker Jinx skin here. Jinx, one of my pet favorite champions here, so seeing a new skin on her for this game is going to be a nice little treat to commentate. Fiddle actually going to cancel the channel early, seeing that shield was up. I'm going to just opt to not deal with that. And actually the cannon minion not being claimed over by this red side here there. Bit of a mistake there, maybe thinking that Leona had her relic shield up a little bit sooner, but unfortunately was not the case. Lux actually gonna zone a little bit. Oh no, missing the charm. Ahri had a great opportunity to get a lot of damage there, especially with Vi so nearby in those camps. Who's gonna actually look to Q, and no, a mistake was made. Actually gonna miss the Q, which only gives her time to burn a flash as well. Very actually risky play there. If she had had any mana, she might have been able to get the kill onto Ahri as well, but that will be the first blood, or excuse me, no, a second kill going over to this blue side, the kill going onto that Vi there, so she'll be going around able to spread that violence around a little bit more effectively now. And unfortunately, I mean, you know, that's one of the bad things about Lux. You don't really have too many options, at least early game, with how to try and avoid ganks and live through ganks there. You just gotta sort of deal with the fact that, you know, you get caught, you're gonna have problems. But hold that thought here, we actually see great snare from Jinx to land those flame chompers down on both of them, comboing with that Leona lockdown. And actually, good flash there to make sure the channel wasn't interrupted and introduced into a lethal combo of CC here. In the top lane there, but we see it looks like Caitlyn's actually going to be poked out of lane here, and Vi trying to create something, but is going to get caught up in the flame chompers herself as well. So Fiddle able to do a fairly good job of trying to farm from afar here, but with how heavily he's been poked out of that lane, with the harass of just getting in your face with those auto attacks, with that knock up channel damage, even able to not really channel it the whole way, but just cancel it early and get what damage you can. As we see, that poke that Sion does offer is not much, but it is enough to continually shove in against this Fiddlesticks. And if Fiddle ever tries to channel to get that heal coming in, he's gonna hold that thought. Though we do see the heal coming in actually pretty strong, not gonna be enough, actually gonna fend them off. Wow, Fiddlesticks just barely surviving, gonna fend off the gank there. Impressive play there from the Fiddlesticks to very calmly just chill, be that stick figure, heal on up. Very good play there. Calm play that I would not have had myself, so great to see that. coming out in the top lane there to actually survive that, and now able to go back, buy those boots, try and avoid some of that harassment, get a ruby crystal as well for a little bit more survivability there, and looking to teleport back into this top lane to grab some of that CS if he can. Hopefully that survivability and that mobility will help him dodge out some of the damage in that top lane, so he can CS a little bit better now. Fiddlesticks obviously struggles quite a bit farming in lane early, so we'll see what we've got here. And Ram is actually going to come in for the gank. Good positioning here, and Braum forced to flash away and jump, and there is no six right now, so he will make it out alive. So unfortunately that will not be a kill going over to this red side yet. They still are starved for kills at this point, and they're almost 1,000 gold behind, but we see Sion coming in the middle lane. Speaking of getting kills, oh, Lux actually misses the Q there, and that will open up the counter gank for this Vi, who with the help of Ahri does get the kill over to Ahri on this Sion, who is not going to be able to do anything in this passive. Unfortunately, a little bit of damage, but not going to be enough there. Kaylin actually doing pretty well under some pressure here, farming under that turret, but going to be taking a little bit of harassment damage there. Hopefully her friend Braum will get back down there and be able to protect her a little bit more. I'm a little surprised actually seeing how strongly this Jinx has been able to control the lane phase. Obviously, Leona helps you do that quite a bit. But Jinx, obviously one of the strongest late game hyper carries, has a very weak early game. So to see her just using those rockets on everybody quite a bit, using that zap to harass very strongly and pushing them out to gain what has jumped into a 20 CS lead here by 8 minutes. Very impressive, actually, from both her and the top lane. There's another 20 CS lead onto that Sion over Fiddlesticks as well. So of course, Fiddlesticks has a bit harder time dealing with that than the Caitlyn does, but still very impressive play from both the top and bottom lane there. Unfortunately, Lux has been, actually, as we see, Lux almost taking out that Vi. Vi just barely going to make it away, as we see, not going to be enough damage. Vi just now getting over 20 hit points. So she must have been taken incredibly low there. That's horribly unfortunate for this Lux. I mean, if she was able to, just by an amplifying tomb, instead of those fairy charms, she had gotten a little bit more CS and not been zoned so hard in the laning phase. Unless being zoned more of just being dead because she's been killed twice now. That would have been possibly the kill right there, just a little bit more damage being eked out would have been enough to 100-0. And here we see the taunt coming in as well with the ultimate up. And that will be Fiddlesticks. No, gonna flash just out of range of the ultimate. He's gonna, no, not be able to channel just outside of the nick of time. And that Sire, that Rammus, so low as well. 60 hit points. Very low. And we're gonna see probably the top lane turret going down. Nobody in ranged to try and respond to that, unfortunately. So with the teleport about to be up, Fiddlesticks might be able to try and teleport top to stop that, but we'll have to wait and see what he decides to do here. It looks like that wave was not enough for Sion, but a good kill onto that Sion, definitely something that Sion needed to start getting going here in the top lane if he's going to go for what looks to be a little bit more damage early. And the Vi ultimate is up, so once she has vision, she will be able to go on the hunt there and chase that Jinx down, who is able to flash away, but critically does have to use that flash. Caitlyn, a little late to the party, actually. Gonna be getting that ult, gonna be blocked by the Leona, and gonna have to flash away herself. Rammus forcing them away, actually forcing the teleport even. Fiddle, gonna cancel that teleport. Wow, so I mean, a little speechless there. Very bloody early game in this, the opening here for this matchup. We're seeing quite a bit of trades and quite a bit of very close calls for a few people going back and forth here. So I am very thoroughly impressed by both sides' ability to try and manage what's left of their health bars after these trades. And overall, despite those three kills going over to this blue side and a 3-1 kill advantage, the gold advantage is only a couple hundred, a very negligible amount, as we see right now it bounces to near nothing. So the CS, especially in this top lane that we see here, great fear by Fiddle to interrupt that channel. But the CS overall in this top lane is like nearly double onto the Scion. That's just painful to have. As we see the red side looking to set up for this dragon here. Now that they know they have that teleport advantage, they're going to be looking to get this for free right now, as Fiddle shouldn't at least be able to answer to do anything about it. Ahri looking to try and do something with Braum. Actually, Braum flashing in to try and set something up here. He does get the Glacial Fissure onto all of them, but it wasn't quite enough. Ahri able to take out that Leona, actually, and gonna take out the Vi as well. Actually, a double kill onto this Ahri. Or, excuse me, gonna take out the Jinx as well. So, two kills onto Ahri. Please, disregard the Peanut Gallery and myself. Great decision to flash over that wall, knowing that you actually had a team that would follow up and be able to get with that follow up the right targeting onto the right champions. That was overall definitely worth it. Two for Dragon there. Two for zero with Dragon going over as well. So, definitely something that you want to get going early when you have a champion like Ahri who's going to look to try and assassinate out people in the later game. Gonna focus down this turret and try and turn onto this Leona with the Braum here as well. Actually, gonna be able to lock her down with the Braum passive, and no, that will be Vi going down. Took a little bit too much damage, and actually, that will probably be the Caitlyn going down as well, thanks to that Scion teleport. Question is, will we see the catcher, the Zap, gonna land? I'm not sure if we'll be able to. We see the channel. Oh, and a good sidestep by Braum, though. Viva la Braum, gonna just make it out of there with chair in tow. So it looks like Scion's gonna try and clear out this wave really quickly to create some pressure in this bottom lane, which will force Braum to hang around a little bit to try and stop this turret from going down, as we see Fiddle lurking around in those bushes, possibly looking to set up an ultimate, which is up. He's in the back. He has revealed himself now, so red side's gonna think a little bit better of it and just go ahead and head on back. As I see Vi taking that blue buff for herself right now. Gonna clear out that camp. We see a lot of the ward wars going around right now. We have a lot of defensive posturing from the wards, but it looks to be serving well because it's spotting out this red side as they try and push in to get some damage and try and catch anyone from this blue side out. We look over to Fiddle, slowly backing away here now that they are starting to pile into this bottom lane. They're going to full-on commit to trying to get this bottom lane turret. Leona actually opting not to throw out the ultimate there to try and create a fight, knowing that Jinx still had quite a ways to go wearing down this turret. But it looks like the answer turret actually doesn't want to be something that is messed with here in the top lane. Vi actually going to flash away before the turret is finished. I think she missed out on that local gold as well, thinking that one last auto would have been enough, but unfortunately it was not. So Vi going to have to burn the flash, but we'll get that global gold out to the rest of her team as the final outer tier turret does fall for the red side. So that is one turret in advantage for this blue side here. And critically, that is the middle lane turret, so that gives them quite a bit of amount of flexibility here to try and prevent any sort of pincering throughout their jungle and allow them a little bit more breathing room when getting these wards. But just as I say that, of course, the red side going to try and make that change, and Ahri going to get jumped on. Actually, the Leona ultimate not landing, but Fiddle's ultimate does, and he's actually going to get blown up by the Lux, though. And the Jinx gonna be able to, no, Lux gonna be able to finish her off, and that will only be the Leona going down. Scion looking to just charge through here, get a little bit of damage on his way by. But overall, that is a 2-for-1 in favor of the red side. Both supports going down, but also the top lane Fiddlesticks dying. a good trade for the red side overall. Good rotation, especially since they started that as the sieging team, getting that damage onto that turret in the middle lane, which they will definitely be sure to return to. Good grouping up in that area to try and get that extra map flexibility into play here, as we see Vi jumping around here trying to clean out that jungle, throw down a little bit more vision into the pit here, as we see Dragon looking to spawn here in a minute 20. Vi gonna look to grab that scuttle crab after warding the back of the pit here. Now crab will time out a little bit early before that dragon does spawn. So Vi actually gonna do some counter jungling, living a little dangerously here. Gonna try and turn on the Scion. Didn't realize everyone was there. Gonna just choose to burn her ultimate to try and delay the inevitable there, but gonna go down, and that's another kill on Lux. And all of a sudden, I'm starting to feel like I've seen this game before. The Lux Q, the Lux R, and somebody dies. I feel like I know this. So, we do see this Lux opting for a little bit more of a defensive route here. We do see that the Fiend's Unholy Grail coming out. Senshi was a little bit behind, trying to get a little bit more defensive stats into her build, but after those four kills now, we're going to definitely be seeing this Lux change up that strategy and go a lot more aggressive here. Look to slide on into a death cap probably for her next item. With those boots completed for the extra penetration, it's going to likely be just some raw AP damage here. As we do see the red side setting up for this dragon, they're actually not going to be able to clear out that pink ward just yet, and that will be their ward going down. And now that the Skull Crab has timed out... Oh no, Braum has been caught, and here we go. The defensive route actually flashed over the Chompers, but still went down to Lux, and now that's a 5-2 Lux. And now, with this dragon starting off here, this is a 5-4. It was only the Braum down, but that is a lot of passive CC that they're going to be missing on. If they do decide to contest this, and Fiddle gonna try the channel, gonna jump in, and they steal it! Ahri successfully ends up being the one to grab it, and that's two kills from the burst of jumping over to the other side of the dragon pit. But those two kills are, unfortunately, three kills are answered now. So this blue side, actually, Caitlyn accepting her fate, gonna try and return what damage she could. But that will be overall a 4-2, so despite getting the dragon, they went a little ham on that engage, which, you know, convinced me, getting those two kills right off the bat. Certainly nothing to sneeze at, but it was just the Rammus and the Leona. And with the Scion there, still able to tank up a lot of that damage with that Warden's Mail completed. Was able to tank enough to where the squishies of the Lux and the Jinx were able to just do a more condensed but still effective backline and put out that DPS to turn that fight around. So overall, the fight does go in favor of the red side despite losing that dragon. And specifically, let's remember that is the first dragon over to this red side. So it is a very, this blue side, excuse me. So it is a very critical dragon, and it's important that they delay that third dragon from the red side as long as possible to make sure that one of their just outright weaknesses in their team's composition, the lack of mobility on everyone except for that Rammus. They want to be able to continue to prolong that weakness as long as possible, so they'll be able to try and not get caught, because if you get caught by the red team, you're going to be done. So delaying that third dragon as long as possible to deny that movement speed increase is going to be key here for the blue side, and they did decide to commit to that full on in that last dragon, but it did end up costing them a very costly exchange here. And we see Vi actually going to have to queue away with a lot of damage. The charm coming out onto Scion, not the best target there. Rammus did use his ultimate, but not necessarily the most critical ultimate onto that guy. So not necessarily going to mean they'll give up the siege here. Actually, not able to stop that recall. And they're going to go all in here with that Leona engagement. The turret shots are going on to Leona, the best target. Actually going to take her down, though. So that is 2-3. just two for two, actually. With the turret shots and with Jinx trying to strutter stuff, actually going a little bit too deep under that turret without any minion cover. Gonna mean that that's a 2-for-2 overall. I would say in favor of this blue side, despite that turret going down. That is a trade they wanted to have happen here. After, like, because they engaged, as soon as they saw that Vi recall, Leona threw out her ultimate. Leona dove in with that Zenith Blade. And to be able to trade 2-for-2 when it was a 5v4 like that, with the engaged jump on the enemy's favor, that's a pretty good trade overall, despite being sort of, overall in the macro perspective, out-rotated to lose that turret. But we see the turret score even up now. All outer turrets are down in this game. So we're going to see a lot more possibility for picks on both sides in this river area. And we'll see. Again, the story of this game has not been, very critically, aside from that last dragon, has not been a surprise, here's everyone piling on a couple of your heads and instantly blowing people up. If the blue side really wants to start using their comp to its utmost effectiveness, I would argue that they need to start warding up, getting a lot of that vision control in what's now all contested area around the river for both sides, and set up some death brushes here and try and catch some people out. As we toggle through the mini-maps here, we see both sides don't have the best vision. Actually, I take that back. The blue side has quite a bit of vision thrown out. It's not necessarily coordinated into specific areas at this point, but that is a lot of vision overall on the map. And Leona, not the target they want, but it's taking a little bit of damage. They're going to just chug through some pots, be all right. But we do see Jinx the Turret Destroyer trying to take out this middle turret here on the inner turret. And that actually is Vi caught out with the Lux ultimate. That will be plenty to finish her off. Rom, again, not the target they want, but the target they get. And no, target denied. Rom actually going to make it out of there all right. And that will be the Fiddlesticks going down as well. But here comes the turns. No. Actually, Sion barely making it out. I cannot believe that Sion made it. I had already counted him as dead. And I was talking about if that Lux went down as well, that would have been the turnaround of the fight. Let's look. Let's go back and watch this again. I can't believe how that Sion made it out of here. Let's pay attention to this Ahri, because she was the one who was putting out a lot of this damage. But Leona going to get blown up. And Sion taking some turret shots here. Going to just be ignored by this Caitlyn. One auto attack would have done it. Caitlyn just getting a single Q there. If she had done one auto before then, that would have been disaster for her. And Lux, as we saw earlier, able to avoid narrowly that death from the Ahri, who was chasing her down quite hard. So overall, very well played by this red side here to trade 3-for-2 in that engage. Another engagement in their favor, and they're slowly but surely making these trades start to pile up in their favor as we look at the gold advantages now. 3k in the lead in favor of this red side here. And there's no real one person in particular who has been shut down. The only person who's really taken a lot of deaths is that Leona, and if there's somebody you want to suffer some deaths, it's going to be a support for sure. So Leona doing her job there, creating a lot of opportunities for the rest of her team, allowing that Lux to get huge, which, I mean, let's take a look again after this engagement here. It looks like Leona actually going to get the full stun onto them, and with the Jinx, no, actually going to be chased down. A little miscommunication, it seems, as Caitlyn didn't have the right target. Oh, the Jinx rocket actually going to miss it, though, so that will be Vi going down. It looks like Caitlyn didn't have the best follow-up and actually got caught in the flame chompers from Jinx. So it looked like there was a little miscommunication there of whether or not they were about to dive harder or not. And that will cost them the Vi. And with the Vi down, that means that this dragon will be not able to be contested by a smite. So will be secured easily by the Ram is here, despite the vision for the blue side. And that is the second dragon over to this red team now, as we see them grouped, looking to push up and take, finish what they started last time and actually get this middle turret here. All the members have respawned and now are here for the blue side. But will it be enough? It looks like the red side thinking about abandoning this siege right now. Despite the next wave of minions coming, they're going to think better of that and go back and buy. Looking at their gold really quickly, they're Not a huge amount of gold onto anyone in particular on this red side, but enough to where they're going to decide to just go back, purchase up some items, collect their buffs, do what they can here. So we see the buffs going over to their appropriate laners. Actually, Vi going to be collecting all the buffs here for her side, putting them onto herself. Definitely not the worst thing in the world to have a blue buff onto that fiddle, of course, for the mana being the caster he is. But for that cooldown reduction on his ultimate, but I think a more critical cooldown for this blue team is going to be that Vi ultimate. It's just far more reliable engagement rather than Fiddle, who can be blown up once he engages, as he is unfortunately a little bit short of getting that Zonia's right now. So probably the wise decision to put that cooldown reduction onto the Vi, so she'll be able to start off some more engagements a little bit better. But if they're going to continue to put that blue buff on a Vi, I mean, we need to see these death brushes being set up. We need to see that ward coverage in the river area, and we need to see Vi starting off a pick for her team. As we see, instead, Vi actually just getting 1v1 by this Jinx here, and oh, actually flashes into that, trying to flash over the wall. She ends up flashing into the Jinx ultimate. The trajectory being shown a little bit earlier, but still not able to dodge it out the flash. Looked like she missed the wall because she decided at the last second to try and go elsewhere to dodge that Jinx rocket, but ended up not being able to move that cursor quickly enough and took the rocket. And that will be, with the smite gone, a free Baron to this red side. And with that, it will be the Baron going down. Not even going to use the smite. Didn't have it up. Not even going to need it because it was not contested. That will be a 4,000, nearly 5,000 gold lead here in favor of the red side now. And with Baron, they will be able to start sieging a lot more effectively. It will no longer be a question of whether or not we can see good engages like we saw in these middle sieges earlier. It's just going to be a question of whether or not they have minions with them. And unfortunately for the blue side, they have a lot of minions with them right now. So trying to get a lot of good AoE down. Actually, Braum throwing out his ultimate to try and fend people off and get some wave clear on those minions. But Leona just going to dive right in, tanking the turret and going to get the kill for it. We're going to pay attention over here to this Caitlyn, who was killed, and jump back just in time. We'll jump back a little bit to pay attention to the full fight over here. But we do see, so starting off with that Leona tanking it like a boss. And then Fiddle gonna get a good ultimate off and Zonia's as well. But Lux actually not gonna be targeted by this Fiddle at all. Fiddle gets the tunnel vision on the Jinx and is gonna pay for it by missing a free kill onto that Lux. And the ultimate not gonna do enough damage to get the kill, but will look very flashy with Jinx, the turret destroyer in tow. That will be the inner turret going down for this blue side. And unfortunately, the Caitlyn, who remember was trying to counter push, I suppose, in that bottom lane, was ended up being caught out by this blue side, or by this red side here, and giving up her life, which has resulted in a counter push of their own to try and get a lot of damage into this bottom inner turret as well. Vi actually going to be going hard onto this Rammus right now. Not the best target, as Vi is largely about her auto attacks, and Rammus does have that armor built up. Not yet a Thornmail, but he does, of course, have that built-in Thornmail. And with all the minions around, still getting that Baron buff up, that's not a fight that's going to go in the blue side's favor. And we start to see the cascade begin. The torrent of water starting to pour, the deluge over this blue team here. As the kills now, nearly 10 kills in the lead here. 9 kills up, 7,500 gold in the lead. Finally able to clear out that pink ward is the red side. Blue side will ping out that there is a pink ward there themselves, but they're just not, the blue side has not been able to make use of any vision control of this, of the pick opportunities their composition allows. If you can lock somebody down with an RE charm, with a Vi Q, even not necessarily even her ultimate, but just a Q, that'll allow them enough time to start the Braum stack going and actually get that stun around. There's a lot of CC potential, but they just have not been setting up the death brushes that they needed if they want to get in this lead here. And Vi will be throwing down that smite, as she does have the second one charged up for a little wave clear here. So she will have her smite up in time for the dragon. But it looks like that will be a hard dragon to contest. It will be, if it goes over to the red side, it will be their third dragon of the game. Only one dragon onto this blue team as of yet. So that extra movement speed going to be very critical. And once they get that third dragon, see, this is what I'm talking about. This death brush here. Vi, knowing the timer on that dragon, is going to want to check. She's a little bit delayed by this red buff here and is going a little bit slower because she might be afraid. But even without that, she's going to be absolutely destroyed. Even with the safety of not going into the death brush, just getting hooked around, getting the advance warning of the zap trigger there. Just going to die regardless. And that is another uncontestable objective, as there is no smite going over to this red side. And red side just seems to be doing all the things they need to do in this game if they're going to want to continue to snowball that lead. They're staying grouped. They're positioning themselves in the right way to get more catches out with the catch potential they do have. And you just got to feel like there's not much that can be done to stop this Indigo Slate team right now. As we see Braum having to defensively ultimate under his own turret. Fiddle going to actually dodge out a lot of damage by using that ultimate to jump under his turret, but miss the Zonias critically, so he will end up dying without the benefit of that stasis. But overall, they did get that Leona, so it was a 2-for-1 in favor of the red side, but certainly could have been worse here. Oh, the charm just barely missing on Ahri. Could have been a great chance to get that Jinx done. Taken out, I should say. But we do see some hero minions in the bottom lane, I believe. Yes, that's right. Ram is not the best at wave clear, so gonna not be able to save that turret, unfortunately. So maybe that a little inject of extra gold going over to the blue side will be enough to get them rolling on their item breaks here. Give me one moment. Sorry about that, I had to mute my mic for just a moment here. As we see, Vi coming around, picking up that blue buff again. And you know, again, specifically, they just keep giving me reasons to talk about this, but if you're going to be giving that blue buff over to Vi instead of Ahri, instead of Fiddlesticks, the reason you're doing that has to be to lower that cooldown on the Q, on the Vi ultimate, to get those picks. And it's not wrong. I'm emphasizing to you viewers, my lovely viewers, that it is right to give that Vi the blue in this situation. But what is not right is what has happened. Vi has not been using that blue effectively in order to really make use out of the cost, the inherent cost of not giving it over to Ahri, of not giving it over to Fiddlesticks. There is an inherent cost to that, and it doesn't seem like Vi has been paying those dues just yet. And it looks like Spell Shield actually going to keep Braum from being engaged on there, but just going to get annihilated. Even tanky Braum going to go down. And that will be a double, no, not a double kill, but two kills going over to this blue side. And with Jinx on that turret, that will be the turret going down. And it looks like, it feels like it's just a matter of time once you get yourself so aware a near 10,000 gold lead is in your fortune. It's hard to try and see a way to come back. Jinx cracking open the base here as they take this middle inhibitor, and we'll have siege minions coming in from this wave forward down. And it looks like they're actually going to back off right to this Baron area, knowing they have the ward control. Throwing down a little bit of wards behind them as well to make sure that if it is contested, they will full well know it. And it looks like it probably will not be able to be contested. The blue side getting slowed down by minions. They're pinging, a little afraid that there's going to be any more catches. So that will be an uncontested Baron going over to this red side. And now it's probably just going to be a matter of going back, purchasing with this large amount of gold that beautiful Lux wave clear there. Cashing in nearly 2k gold on everyone. To try and get some nice new items, then picking a lane, probably the middle lane, with those super minions starting to stream in as well. Burying up those guys will be just a nightmare to have to deal with for this blue side. And they, it feels like it'll just be a matter of time before they get some of these nexus turrets starting to fall here. We do want to see the blue side come back. I mean, there's always a way. It's League of Legends. I've seen many a game way more far gone than this come back. But the reason I sound so pessimistic is not just because of the score, but because I have not seen anything from this blue side that has convinced me they will be playing in a fashion that will get them caught back up. They have been only getting kills essentially onto that Leona, and the only reason is because Leona, being Leona, will go way deep to start off these engages, which have been working overall, clearly looking at the score in the favor of the red side here. But I have yet to see, hold that thought, we gotta pay attention to this fight going on over here, by taking out of the picture almost immediately by that Rammus, and Lux and Jinx actually not hitting anyone critical with their ultimates, but Fiddlesticks does end up going down here, and that will be the turret going down as well, as we look to see this siege forming here in the bottom lane to get this turret. Rammus forcing people away here, actually gonna get jumped on with that Leona as well, and now the turret and the champions, oh, which will fall first? That ramping damage onto the Rammus is actually gonna force a flash out of Rammus, but that will be the inhibitor for this bottom lane as well, going down, and with super minions already in the base, that's probably the end of the game here, as we see Jinx just wailing away with that minigun onto this Nexus, and one final kill, no! The one final kill will be on Caitlyn going over to Lux here. So that will be the game going in favor of Indigo Slate on the red side. So let's take a quick look at the after game stats here to try and just get a better picture of what had happened here. Again, I mean, when you see a 12-3 and 15 Jinx, a 11-2 and 14 Lux, I mean, there's nothing you can do in that situation when it gets that much out of control. The real problem is just letting it get to a point where it spirals that hard. Even the 7-1-9 Sion, let's looking at the damage specs really quickly here. We see Caitlyn got in a lot, or Ahri, excuse me, got in a lot of damage with that AoE, but even Ahri, as the primary damage dealer for this blue side, got just completely outmatched by that damage from the Jinx, from the Lux. Could not hold a candle to them. Came close to the Lux, but Jinx, just an absolute monster. Typically, we'll see sometimes AD carry scores for the damage to champions a little bit lower because they're so focused on farming, on putting that damage on turrets, but Jinx, an absolute nightmare. More than any two players on the blue side is Jinx's damage total. So, just great play from the Jinx to actually get that damage onto the target she needed to create those kills to get her team going and make this the game it turned out to be, that just so heavily went in favor of this Indigo Slate team on the red side. So without further ado, that is the match, again, going in favor of the Indigo Slate team on the red side over Team Crunchyroll on the blue side. So if you enjoyed this game, feel free to plug in with the rest of After Hours Gaming League content. If you go to their After Hours Gaming League website, the full schedule will be posted there. The matches will be posted there once they're uploaded. And stay tuned to my channel. I will be casting for the rest of today. I will have my stream up every Sunday when I cast these games. And about around an hour and a half after each game is cast, I will be uploading them. So stay tuned to my channel for any, if you want to look back on these games not live, feel free to come back here shortly or review any games that have been posted previously, and I will continue to post those up as I cast more games in the future. But without further ado, thank you for tuning in. I appreciate it, and I hope you had a good time.